Dear distinguished UPOV members, dear colleagues and friends, it is a great honor for Danziger Danflower Farm and Danziger Innovation, and for me personally, to have been invited to come and talk in front of this prominent community. Thank you, Mr. Button. I am very happy and excited as I see many good friends. I would also like to make this opportunity to thank the Opora team headed by Mr. Steve Houghton, Mr. Edgar Krieger, the board members and all other team members that represent us diligently as we could not manage to get the job done alone. I would like also to thank the Israeli Ministry of Agriculture, which has given this issue priority, and Ms. Moran Cohen, as she has taken the time to represent the Israeli standpoint at this meeting. I was granted the privilege to speak here, unfortunately, due to the extensive experience gained over the years of battles to protect Danziger IP in the Million Star Gypsophila variety, which were aggressively violated by numerous mutants in several countries, Israel, the Netherlands, Ecuador, and others. Moreover, the Danziger Group has several companies. In Danziger Danflower Farm, we utilize advanced classic breeding techniques, whereas in Danziger Innovation Ltd, we implement new breeding techniques, mainly genome editing. Thus, we are aware of both initial breeder and EDV breeder interests. It all started with a vision of a young couple 65 years ago. They sowed the seeds for us to imagine more in our day-to-day, a vision which has become a global company. Our focus is on the beauty of ornamental flowers, vegetatively bred. We breed a steady stream of new innovative varieties using our expertise and imagination implemented by a team of more than 1,500 people around the globe with over 100 professionals in our research and breeding team developing high-quality products and processes. Today, our operations are spread all around the globe. We have production facilities not only in Israel, but also in Kenya, Guatemala, Colombia, and China. Our major focus is on advanced research and development. In Danziger Innovation, we utilize our genome editing patented technology to a variety of different crops other than ornamentals, such as lettuce, and have a special expertise in the Solanaceae family, like potatoes, tomatoes, pepper, petunia, and tobacco. As breeder, we invest heavily in R&D, and especially in breeding, our creation and asset derived from these efforts are of immense significance. Therefore, enforcement of plant breeder rights and IP protection of related agri-technologies is our utmost importance. All breeders need to exert best efforts on enforcing plant breeder rights throughout the world, as we are operating in an era of globalization, which calls for unified standards worldwide. Moreover, in order to collect royalties on varieties which breeder has largely invested in IP rights must be enforced. It is clear that we are operating in an industry which has undergone and will continue to undergo accelerated process such as automation and robotization. We must honor the rights of all those creating enabling technology which will promote efficient and profitable production. Likewise, we must make sure that our IP is protected in the best and most efficient ways. The issue of essentially derived varieties has been raised and added to the 99 UPOV Convention due to the occurrence of commercialization of mutants of leading market varieties where the breeder of the initial commercial variety did not receive any royalties from mutant sales. 28 years have passed since then, and just think how immensely the world evolved since then. It takes many years and enormous funds to breed, introduce, and market a successful variety. In order to maintain the source of innovation, we must have a sufficient return on investment throughout appropriate IP protection. Many new ornamental varieties are the basis for the development of mutants, natural, induced, or otherwise developed by new breeding techniques. In order to provide an indication of the extent mutant breeding, Siopora approached some European breeders in the ornamental market. The figures shown here are estimates of the percentage of color mutants variety on the market with each crop group. This gives some idea on the extent of mutants breeding in the industry. In chrysanthemum, for example, indications show that where there is a top variety on the market, which mutate easily, the percentage can be as high as 80%. This was the case with the Reagan series some years ago. So, on average, we estimate 50% of chrysanthemum varieties are mutants. Without adequate protection of the initial variety, the number of mutants would rise even further. In vegetatively reproduced ornamental crops, the EDV concept is all about mutants, GMO, and now also new breeding techniques. Creating a mutant may be quick and easy in some aspects, such as traditional breeding, yet creating a mutant may be more complex and expensive in other aspects, such as new breeding technologies. However, in both cases, developers of mutants deliberately choose a valuable initial variety as the source of their mutant, as they wish to benefit from its genetics and marketing added value. For this reason, the initial breeder should be commercially compensated. A sufficiently broad and clear EDV definition is required in order to avoid lack of stability in the IP regime. For example, the Million Star Blankanievich cases results from was opposite court ruling with respect to the exact same varieties due to lack of clear EDV definition. Danziger Million Star Gypsophila was breakthrough in Gypsophila breeding and in 3 years gained major market share in the global Gypsophila market. Almost 20 years ago, when many tried to convince Danziger not to go to court, we held that it is crucial to solve the challenges of this issue, since the interpretation of the EDV clause has major implication for vegetative breeders in terms of strength or weaknesses of their plant breeding rights. It is imperative to have a clear interpretation which maintains the initial variety holder rights. For example, in the Million Star Blankanievich case, the different court ruled contradicting ruling. In court number one, the variety declared to be an EDV, although having 17 morphological differences compared to Million Star. All differences were proven to be a result of the act of derivation. It was a polyploid, doubling the chromosome. In court number two, the opposite decision was ruled. Blankanievich was found not to be an EDV due to the number of differences. Conducting IP court cases are time-consuming and very, very expensive. Most of the ornamental breeders don't have the resources to spend so much time and money on court cases, as we breeders prefer to work in the field and breed rather than being in courtrooms. This legal path can be taken only in extreme cases, protecting a very unique and successful variety. This was the case with Danziger Million Star. We at Danziger had to face several court court cases in order to protect our and our customers' lawful customer rights. Varieties derived from the initial variety, but not retaining all the essential characteristics of the initial variety. And even if all morphological difference results from the act of derivation, may not consider an EDV according to the UPOV current explanatory note. According UPOV explanatory note today, the difference between the EDV and the initial variety should be one or very few, even if all morphological difference results from the act of derivation. According to UPOV explanatory notes today, if a variety does not retain the, meaning all essential characteristic of the variety, it will not be an EDV. In our point of view, as breeders of vegetative reproduced varieties, we believe that the number of difference or their nature does not matter. If you create a mutant or GMO out of initial variety, it is an EDV, as long as the difference are the results of the act of derivation. Excluding most mutants and GMO from the EDV concept by way of a very narrow definition of EDV would be harmful to the initial breeder rights and to the ongoing innovation. We can mention some example we find awkward typical in ornamental that would not be an EDV under the current explanatory note of UPOV. Color mutants, longer shelf life, different growth habit, disease resistance. Just imagine that a color mutant is not an EDV. This is the most common mutant in the ornamental industry, which many times is very easy to create. As mentioned before, the percentage of color mutants on the market is tremendous and will rise further without appropriate EDV definition. We believe varieties resulting from NBT are mutation, exactly as natural old-fashioned mutation are, because they retain almost the whole genome of the initial variety. The reason to choose a specific initial variety and use NBT to modify it is the initial variety's advantages. Otherwise, please feel free to use an open, unprotected variety. In our opinion, the type of technology creating a mutant does not matter. Whether old-fashioned mutation breeding or NBT, it is still a mutant, and the developer should commercially compensate the initial breeder. We understand that NBT can result in significant improvements compared to the initial variety, but still the overwhelming part, 100% plus or minus a tiny fraction of the genome of the new variety comes from the initial variety. And we feel it would be unfair to the breeder of the initial variety not to respect this. Danziger hold the opinion, even though we have Danziger Innovation, a patent new breeding technology called Memogen, enabling creation of site-specific mutation. The Danziger group respect the IP of others as we expect others to respect our IP. We honor IP rights as we understand the importance of the protection granting return on investment to the breeder for many years of investment of time, funds, manpower in the breeding, sales, marketing, and commercialization of a new variety. We honor IP rights as we want the genetic germplasm to evolve. Therefore, should Danziger want to use another breeder patent variety, for example, a variety with utility patent, Danziger will request the license from the other breeder and will sign a binding agreement that authorizes the use. We at Danziger don't create mutants, EDV, using classical breeding nor new breeding technology without the permission of the initial breeder, and we don't intend to do so. Therefore, we hope that the narrow interpretation of UPOV for the EDV concept will not stay as is, as the risk of the current interpretation is that it will lead all breeders to take advantage of the legal loophole whereby mutant breeders can get away without having the initial breeder's authorization. As emphasized, we are totally against it. In our modern world, most of the ornamental variety lifespan is between 3 to 5 years. Sometimes they are taken out of the catalog even before they granted with the PBR. Nevertheless, unique varieties having the wow effect may benefit from a longer lifespan, being a leading variety for many years yet. Yet, mutants can easily harm the success of this very unique variety. Granting the right for a mutant to be commercialized in the market without compensating the breeder of the initial variety harms the balance of market forces. The breeder business strategy and the business model are based on prediction of performance of their unique varieties. The EDV breeder has made a minimal investment in EDV, yet enjoyed the gain of the initial variety prominent market position, while the initial breeder invests heavily not only in breeding but all along the value chain, exerting extensive efforts and capital on receiving marketing recognition. Small and medium breeders, many of them highly innovated, will not have the resources to compete with the big companies, surely not in courts, and surely not if the law is unclear and the results of the dispute is unpredictable. Small, medium-sized breeder will face great difficulty protecting their varieties, and hence the genetic resources and progress will be compromised. Initial breeders should be given the right to control the commercialization of the mutants and GMO of their own bred varieties. It is necessary that the owner of the initial variety will give his consent to commercialization the derived variety. This stems from the clear fact that those who modify the initial variety intentionally modify the initial variety. Due to its attributes, they did not choose to modify a different variety. This intention creates the obligation for the mutant variety holder to approach the breeder of the initial variety to discuss rights and terms of commercialization and profit share subject to each party's efforts and contribution, as is customary in the patent arena. Negotiation between breeders should be addressed on a case-by-case value, which will be decided between the parties based on commercial value and the wow effect. A fair and balanced solution is needed since the EDV concept has huge commercial impact on the industry. To conclude, would it be reasonable to take a patent pencil and add a razor at the end to change the color of the pencil and claim that this is a new independent product that can be commercialized without the need to compensate the patent pencil holder? Would it be honest to create a mutant in a fruit variety which a breeder worked on for a decade, improve or modify it a little bit, and then claim this was a totally new variety? Or maybe modify only a color of a flower and claim this was entirely new flower? To summarize, when vegetative propagation is the chosen propagation method, in vegetative reproduction, without a doubt, predominant derivation is given if only one parent is involved. And this is the key aspect of the EDV concept. Any and all mutants are EDV. All mutants, irrespective of the number and type of modification different from initial variety, as long as the differences stems from the act of derivation. The mutant is an EDV. all mutants, irrespective of breeding techniques, are EDV. Breeders of initial variety and EDV breeder will negotiate the proportion of each breeder contribution to the finance added value of the EDV. The UPOV explanatory note must reflect the present and prepare the future, taking into consideration the rights of the initial breeder in the name of progress and innovation. Therefore, we request the revision of the explanatory note to introduce a clear and broader EDV definition. A broad and clear EDV definition will avoid infringement, high expenses and time court cases, waste of resources, and will enhance innovation and progress. To the best of my knowledge today, more than ever, the breeders, both vegetative and seed breeders, breeders of field crops, vegetable, fruit, ornamental, and biotech companies all stand together in anticipation to have a clear EDV concept to work with, to have UPOV explanatory note revised. Today, our world of breeders expand. Today, our world of breeder expands to many countries. The significance of EDV and incorporation in all various legal systems around the globe has become crucial. Thank you, and if you have any questions, it will be on account of the coffee break.